Our first reading comes out of Psalm 118 from the New Living Translation. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever.
In my distress, I praise the Lord, and the Lord answered me and set me free.
The Lord is for me, so I will have no fear. What can mere people do to me?
Yes, the Lord is for me. He will help me. I will look in triumph at those who hate me.
It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in people.
It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes.
The Lord is my strength and my song. He has given me victory.
Songs of joy and victory are sung.
The strong right arm of the Lord is raised in triumph. The strong right arm of the Lord has done glorious things.
I will not die. Instead, I will live to tell what the Lord has done.
The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not let me die.
Open for me the gates where the righteous enter, and I will go in.
These gates lead to the presence of the Lord, and the godly enter there.
I thank you for answering my prayer and giving me victory.
The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Please, Lord, please save us. Please, Lord, please give us success.
Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord.
The Lord is God, shining upon us. Take the sacrifice and bind it with cords on the altar.
I did get lost, Bruce. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever.
Yep, not the first time I got lost, won't be the last. Yep, welcome to a house where we celebrate all the messes and mistakes. Oh, well, you know, the good news is that, you know, people often say, well, I can't go to church. You know, the roof would fall in. And I'm like, you know, you don't understand. God has called me to be a pastor. If you knew me in my old life, you would go, what the chicken? So, you know, we're all imperfect people. We're all sinners in need of a Savior. And the good news is that his love has saved us and redeemed us and makes us new. Well, there's a story about a man, his wife, and the wife's mother, the man's mother-in-law, who went on vacation to the actual Holy Land. And while they were there, unfortunately, the mother-in-law, who was rather elderly and in poor health, suddenly passed away. So the husband and the wife, they go to meet with the local funeral director, who gave them a couple of options and said, well, you can have your mother-in-law's body shipped home for $5,000, or you can actually bury her right here in the Holy Land, and that's only $150. Without even consulting his wife, the man told the funeral director they would just have her shipped home. And rather surprised by the man's quick decision, the funeral director said, well, I'm just curious. I mean, why would you spend $5,000 to ship your mother-in-law's body home when it would be so wonderful, such a blessing to have her buried right here in the Holy Land, and that would only cost you $150? Well, the man said, listen, a man died here 2,000 years ago, was buried here, and 3 days later he rose from the dead. I just can't take that chance. My apologies to all the mothers-in-law. Well, clearly that man knew and he believed in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and it is indeed a true story that we celebrate today. So we're going to be talking a little bit of the Gospel of Luke. And let me just give you a quick background again. As we've said before, Luke is the only non-Jewish writer of the Gospels, four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He's the only non-Jewish one. He's a Gentile. And he's actually a medical doctor by practice. And he writes about 30 years after the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus. And in the Gospel of Luke, he is writing to a guy by the name of Theophilus. And Theophilus is believed to be a Roman friend of Luke's and a Gentile. And also Luke then is writing to other Gentiles, other non-Jewish people. And here's his opening introduction to the Gospel from Luke. And this is from the Contemporary English Version, beginning with chapter 1, verse 1. Here's what Dr. Luke writes. He says, "Many people have tried to tell the story of what God has done among us. They wrote what we had been told by the ones who were there in the beginning and saw what happened. So I made a careful study of everything and then decided to write and tell you exactly what took place." So by way of that introduction, Luke is simply trying to set the stage and let everyone who reads his gospel account know how much he cares about the details, how much he cares about the accuracy, how much he cares about the authenticity and the truth of what he is writing, because he is a man of science. Luke is known for his attention to detail. Sir William Ramsay spent 15 years trying to undermine Luke's credentials as a historian to refute the reliability of the New Testament. And after 15 years, he said this: "Luke is a historian of the first rank. This author should be placed along with the very greatest of historians." In other words, this pre-believer realized that what Luke was writing about was actually true. So we're going to read out of his gospel this morning, and this is from the New Living Translation, another translation of scripture, and it's from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. "But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, 'Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day.' Then they remembered that he had said this. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. The story sounded like nonsense to the men, so they didn't believe it. However, Peter jumped up and ran to the tomb to look. Stooping, he peered in and saw the empty linen wrappings. Then he went home again, wondering what had happened." So the Apostle Peter looks in, he sees the empty tomb, He sees the linen wrappings which had been used to carefully wrap Christ's body after his death. And it says that he went back to the others wondering what had happened. And it's clear that there are many people walking around today wondering and who are also pretty clueless about the meaning of the Easter story. And indeed, there are many pre-believers. But the truth is, that's understandable. I mean, really? It's probably one of the most incredible accounts of all time. It's really almost unbelievable. It's almost fantastical. It's almost like a science fiction kind of story, like something that movie writers might make up, you know, of a superhero. But the truth is that the historians have proved that this is actually a true story, that Jesus, in fact, did die on Good Friday, and 3 days later, he rose again from the dead, just as he had said. But I understand that there are people who think this is it. This is all there is to life. That, you know, this is all we get. And once we die, we're just worm food. That's it. That's all there is. If that's the case, then the great late Peggy Lee was right. If you have been around long enough, you'll remember that great 1969 mournful tune, "Is That All There Is?" If that's all there is, my friends, then let's keep dancing. Let's break out the booze and have a ball, if that's all there is. There are many who refuse or are afraid to believe. They're afraid to believe there's something more. They're afraid to believe there's something better. They're afraid to believe that there's something bigger than this life that we have right now in the present. Why? Why would they refuse to believe in this promise of another life after this one? Of a brighter and a better future? Why would we reject the promise of the hope of a new life lived in eternity with the one who saved us from our sins? Because they would have to believe, as I said, the singularly most incredible story of all time. That a Jewish carpenter named Jesus, born in a small town called Bethlehem, who was nothing more than a carpenter for much of his early life, lived in a know-nothing town called Nazareth, and then went on at 33 years of age to die in the city of Jerusalem after being beaten and tortured and hung publicly on a cross for everyone to see, that that same guy, this carpenter Jesus, rose again from the dead some 3 days later after being buried, just as he said he would. Remember in the gospel, the women and his followers had forgotten he'd said this. Now, how do you forget something like if I said to you, oh, you know what, I'm going to die on Tuesday, but on Friday I'm going to come back. Just FYI. Just Sheila, just so you know, down on Tuesday, up back on Friday. Would you forget that? I mean, I know you're a busy girl, but you wouldn't forget that. No, that's a fantastical, ridiculous statement. Somehow they forgot it. Why? Because I think, seriously, to be honest, oh, that's, you know, that's that crazy Jesus talking again. You know how he's doing all those crazy things, raising people from the dead and feeding 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. It's just him talking crazy again. I don't think they actually believed it. And then when the two guys at the tomb, the two angels, said, don't you remember what he told you in Galilee? And they're like, oh, yeah. Oh, they remember that crazy statement he made? Sure enough, it's true. Well, if we dare to believe the story, what's the purpose What's the purpose of this story? What does it mean for you and me here on April 17th, 2022? Well, first of all, for those who might be skeptics, I want to take just a few minutes to look at the proof of the resurrection. And as some of you know, I'm a recovering trial lawyer. And I can tell you, when you're trying a case, it's all about the evidence. It's all about the evidence. You prove your case by the weight of the evidence. If it's a civil case, is it more likely than not that this is true? So what evidence do we have here that Jesus did in fact rise from the dead to begin new life? Five facts that I want to just talk about briefly. Fact number one, both Jewish and Roman soldiers, sources and traditions admit there was an empty tomb, despite the fact that this is not in their best interest. It's not to their credit. It's against their interest to make such an admission. In a trial, they would be considered a hostile witness, a hostile source, because they're making an admission against their own interest. In addition to all four of the gospel accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, while varying in certain details, all record the fact that the tomb in which Jesus' body was laid on Friday was empty on the early morning hours of Sunday. There's a theologian by the name of Paul Althaus, and he states that the resurrection, quote, could not have been maintained in Jerusalem for a single day, for a single hour, if the emptiness of the tomb had not been established as a fact for all concerned. Fact number two. In chapter 27 of Matthew, it says that Pilate told the leading priests and Pharisees, take guards and secure it, meaning the tomb, the best you can. So what did they do? They sealed the tomb and they posted guards to protect it. And not only did they protect it, but they put a stone in front of it, which scholars will tell you weighed about the same as a small car, 1.5 to 2 tons. And that stone was just rolled away as if it was some tiny pebble of insignificant weight. And the seal was broken, and the guards were no longer anywhere to be found. Now, it's the departure, the absence of the guards, that's particularly compelling, you see, because the guards here had failed in their duty. And when a guard failed in their duty, like something like this, to guard a particularly important site, here's what happened to them back in the day. They were executed. So their lives depended, literally their lives depended on keeping this gravesite secure. And one way that they were executed was a guard was put to death by being stripped of his clothes and then burned alive in a fire that was started with his clothes. If it was not apparent which of the guards had failed in their duty, then lots were drawn to see which one would have to be accountable and be executed for the unit's failure. Their lives depended upon securing that tomb. A student of Roman military discipline, a guy by the name of Dr. George Curry, wrote that fear of punishment produced flawless attention to duty, especially in the night watches. And yet these guards had failed to keep the tomb secure and Jesus' body buried. And as a result, man, they left town and they were never heard from again. Fact number three. There were multiple substantive post-resurrection appearances by Jesus to many witnesses. John tells us that Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene, the woman that he healed and delivered from seven demons. Mark tells us there was another woman by the name of Mary. Apparently there's something about that name, Mary, who also saw him at the tomb that morning. There were two disciples on the road to this town called Emmaus. Then he appeared to Peter. Then he appeared to all the apostles. Then again, he made an appearance to the apostles because Thomas, the doubting Thomas, was there. Of course, he makes this famous appearance to a guy who was originally known as Saul, Saul of Tarsus. Later, he becomes the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, who is designated to write almost three quarters of the New Testament. He appears to Paul on the road to Damascus. Paul had spent his life up until that point as a Pharisee persecuting Christians, killing them. He didn't want to believe in a risen Jesus, but he goes on to admit in his letter to the Corinthians in chapter 15 that Jesus appeared not only to him, but 500 people at one particular time. And many of these weren't just like, you know, one of those encounters where you're like, is that you, Jesus? That guy, that bearded guy, doesn't he look like Jesus? Is that Jesus? I think it's Jesus. I don't know. Is it Jesus? Do you think it's Jesus? Oh, no. These are actually encounters where they see him up close, where they hear his voice. They touch him. They eat with him. There's no indication that this is just a fleeting, I think I saw him. Dr. Edwin Yamauchi, it was an associate professor of history at Miami University, he said this: let's take more than the 500 witnesses who saw Jesus alive after his death and burial, place them in a courtroom. Do you realize that if each of these 500 people were to testify for only 6 minutes, which is not very long, including cross-examination, you would have an amazing 50 hours of firsthand testimony. Add to this testimony the many other eyewitnesses, and you would have the largest and most lopsided trial in history. No one acquainted with the facts can accurately say that Jesus appeared just to an insignificant few. And finally, fact number four. No, not finally, because I said there were five. Okay. Glad you're counting with me. Four. The New Testament accounts of the resurrection were being circulated not in hundreds of years later. They were circulated within the lifetime of the men and women who were alive at the time of the resurrection itself. These people would certainly have denied the accuracy of the accounts, and yet no reliable, no documented evidence to the contrary that refutes the historical fact and stunning truth of Jesus' resurrection from the dead. Don't miss the fact that this is something he predicted over and over and over again, more than 20 times in all four Gospels. Why is that important? Because what Jesus says is true. What Jesus says is true. When you read something in Scripture and Jesus said it, you can take it to the bank. It's trustworthy. It's believable. It's credible. It's dependable. It's accurate and it's true. And finally now, point number five, Jesus' disciples, after he'd risen, they didn't go off to Athens or Rome or Paris to preach that he was raised from the dead. No, they went right back to the city of Jerusalem, where if what they were teaching was false, the error would have been quickly evident. But as someone said, the empty tomb was too notorious to be denied. It was too outrageous to be denied. Nope, these apostles went back to their city and they stood their ground and they preached a completely different message. Once not believing all the promises of Jesus, who told them time and time again he'd have to suffer, have to die and be raised again, now telling all who would listen they were wrong. He was right. He spoke the truth. He is the truth. Of the original 12, 10 of them were martyred for their faith. Judas Iscariot committed suicide after having such remorse for having betrayed his friend, his mentor, his teacher, Jesus. And John, it's believed, died of old age. But the ten were executed for their faith. The truth is, people don't die for a lie. People will not die for a lie. But perhaps the most persuasive of all that is transformational is the transformational change that happened within these men. Within them. It says, before they ran away, they denied their master. They huddled behind locked doors in fear and confusion. But after, they were transformed from scared rabbits into confident saints, world-changing missionaries, courageous martyrs, and joy-filled ambassadors for Christ. You see, the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ changed them from the inside out. And if you believe in this crucified and risen Jesus Christ, he will change you from the inside out. The evidence is overwhelming. It's a historical fact. It happened just as Jesus said, but so what? Again, what does that mean for us? Well, here's what the Apostle Paul says, Peter says in 1 Peter verse 18. This is from a translation, very modern translation called The Message. He says this, your life is a journey. You must travel with a deep consciousness of God. It costs God plenty to get you out of that dead end, empty-headed life you grew up in. He paid with Christ's sacred blood, you know. He died like an unblemished sacrificial lamb. And this was no afterthought. Even though it has only lately, at the end of the ages, become public knowledge, God always knew he was going to do this for you. It's because of this sacrificed Messiah who God then raised from the dead and glorified that you trust God, that you know you have a future in God. Very simply put, the power and the purpose of the resurrection means this. You can count on this man, Jesus. You can depend on him. You can believe him. You can trust what he says is true. You can believe the many promises that he makes to us, his people, his children, his creation. It means that Satan does not have a grip on those who believe in Jesus. Sin does not have a grip on those who believe in this man, Jesus. It means that Jesus laughed in the face of Satan on that glorious Sunday morning and said, no more. No more. These are my children. These are my precious lambs. These are my sheep of my flock. And you are not going to be able to touch them in eternity. Not by death, not by disease, not by destruction, not by depression, not by discouragement. And in eternity, you will not be able to break them or bondage them or bankrupt them financially, physically, emotionally, or spiritually. Why? Because I, Jesus, am the source of their riches. I am the source of their light. I am the source of their life. And I am the source of all their hope. And I, Jesus, have overcome this world that they may have life abundant and rich in me, no matter what you, Satan, try to throw at them in this world. They're mine, and no one and nothing can take them from me. It means that he will never leave us or forsake us when the world walks out on us. He, Jesus, the risen Christ, will walk in. It means that no matter what we've done, no matter where we've been, when we confess our sins to him, he can be trusted to forgive our sins, cleanse us from the inside out, never hold our history of messes and mistakes against us. He'll remember them no more. It means that when he looks at us, he sees us as innocent, as without fault, without sin, without blemish, without defect, but only as images of him, pure and faultless. It means that we can cast every anxiety upon him and he will give us supernatural peace. It means that he will never allow us to go through any trial or trouble or tribulation where his grace is not sufficient to carry us through unto victory. That, my dear friends, is the power and the purpose of the resurrection. And it means that if you don't know this man, Jesus, as your Lord and Savior, he's waiting. He's just waiting for you to say yes to him. He's just waiting for you to believe and receive him. From the book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible, it says, listen, Jesus says, I'm standing at the door of your heart knocking. And if you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. Today, on this Resurrection Sunday, I believe there are some of you who may yet have invited Jesus to come in and be part of your heart, part of your life. And if that's the case, I believe that today is your day that he's ordained from the beginning of time. And I want you to pray in a moment and afford you that opportunity. But also, there might be some people here today who, you know, they've just fallen away. Maybe you've become distant from Jesus. For whatever reason, it doesn't matter. And you just feel this overwhelming need to reconnect with him, to receive a fresh anointing, to make a new commitment, have a new relationship with him on this day that we celebrate, a day of new beginnings. So I'm just going to ask you if you would all just please close your eyes, bow your heads with me, and pray as I invite you to pray silently with me in your heart. Father, in the name of Jesus, open doors in our lives today. Save and set us free. Take back this day everything that the devil has stolen. Emotional health, physical health, finances, relationships, children, jobs, homes, marriages. Cancel every plot, plan, scheme the enemy has devised against us in the name of Jesus. For we declare this day that no weapon formed against us will prosper. And he who is in us, Jesus, is greater than he, Satan, who is in the world. Speak life into every dead situation. We thank you that nothing is over until you say it's over. It is your desire that not one should perish, but all come to know you. And for those who want to answer that call today, you pray silently with me. Lord Jesus, I need you. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. I open the door of my life and trust you as my Savior. Thank you for forgiving my sins and giving me eternal life. Make me the kind of person you want me to be. And do what you need to do to me so that you can do what you want to do through me. Thank you that I can trust you. Amen. Well, at this time, we're going to receive our offering. The ushers are going to come by. If you're